Good morning. It is Saturday, October the 8th. This is Wes Fryer, and I am standing at the edge of the Persian Gulf, which I have been told is called the Arabian Gulf by some of those who are not Iranian. I am basically at the northernmost point of the peninsula where our hotel is located. You can see it's that tall tan building there behind me, and I have just kind of walked along the water and passed a whole bunch of boats, and I'll kind of turn around so you can see here. I am now, what am I facing? It's east, I'm facing south. Behind me is north, and if we were to continue to go north from here, it would be in Iran. So I have now touched the water of the Persian Gulf. It's pretty, the water is pretty clear here, and it's, you know, one of the things that's hard to kind of get your head wrapped around being here in Qatar is what it means to have unlimited petroleum wealth. So one of the people we met this week said that Qatar is basically at about a fifth production for what they can produce. So they're only producing about 20%, and most of their production is natural gas. And it's really, really interesting thinking about oil nationalization and political stability and the history of the region and where things have gone bad and where things are going bad and for governments, and how in here in Qatar everyone basically receives an allotment. There are about 300,000 Qataris, and they have the third largest natural gas field in the world. So the other two are in the Soviet Union. And because of geography and political and economic situations, they're not able to produce nearly as much as they could. So here's some guys who are headed out, I think, to go fishing today. So Qatar just has incredible wealth and a very small number of people. And the emir and his family are owners and controllers of, it sounds like, most everything. It sounds like everyone is a millionaire here. So think about that. Think about being in school, being a teacher, and you know, people who may just work in your building as a custodian may make more than you as the principal. That's the case in with some of the schools here and some of the international schools. Think also about the implications of, for motivation and in the society, money is such an issue in pretty much every other part of the world. And, you know, here it is not for those who are from Qatar. But another thing I thought of, if you, and I don't know that I've read this actual book. I read The Third Wave by Alvin Toffler, and he has another book called Future Shock, an earlier book, and I didn't read that. That book, I understand, you know, talks about how as societies undergoing technological, cultural, demographic change, there's a big shock, like culture shock. And wow, here in Qatar, thinking not only about the technological changes, but you know, within a generation, they've moved from a lot from Bedouins and folks that were living a much less cosmopolitan life to, you know, there's all, I don't know if I can pan over here and you can see this, there's all this that was our hotel, all this construction. We're not even, you know, in a location where we're in the downtown, the most downtown in area with built-up skyscrapers. One of the thought that I'll add, just kind of putting the pieces together here, or trying to, is, you know, what's happened? How is it that since the first Gulf War, we've had this explosion in economic development here? Well, a huge part of it, as you probably know, Osama bin Laden did not want the United States to be in Saudi Arabia. He was Saudi Arabian. He's angry about that, and felt that the infidel had invaded his country and needed to leave and get out. And so that was a big reason for the 9/11 attacks, from what I have read and spoken with people to understand. And so to a real extent, you know, he was successful in his goal because the United States militarily left Saudi Arabia, where we had been for years and years. And so our fleet that's in the Persian Gulf is in Bahrain, but our Air Force is based here in Qatar. And so my understanding is that after the first Gulf War, when we had to move our bases, we made a huge military commitment here to Qatar. And as a result of that military commitment and military stability to this area, and because these lands have been contested by Iran and Saudi Arabia and the Emirates, by Oman, then the petroleum companies, ExxonMobil, Shell, BP, made commitments of billions of dollars to put infrastructure here, which has led to the increased gas production and has led to the situation of nearly unlimited wealth here. So Qatar and the United States are good buddies. You're not going to see the United States supporting armed groups to oppose the government here, as you know we saw in Libya. And it's just very interesting how politics and oil and natural gas and power and all of these things play out here. So anyway, just a few early morning reflections here from the edge of the Persian Gulf in Qatar, Middle East, on October, I don't even remember what I said it was. Is it the 8th? Is it the 9th? I've lost track. I think we're probably going to be back on track with time about the time we leave on Sunday. So, in early October 2011, adios.